Welcome to the 2016 Sea Air Space Expo Sea Service Roundtable session titled Recruit, Train, Retain, Manpower in the 21st Century. I'm Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard, Steve Cantrell, and I will moderate the discussion this afternoon. I want to thank you all for being here this afternoon first, and as we discuss what I think is the most important of all of our sea services, and that's our people. As you've wandered around or had the chance to wander around and see all the new technology down at the expo on the floor, you see great new things for our nation and for our sea services. However, that technology and that capability is worthless without the world-class Marines, sailors, and Coast Guardsmen that operate it. Today, we're going to talk about how we recruit, train, and retain the best workforce this country has ever seen. I have the honor to moderate, and what I'd like to do is introduce the panelists first, and they will, after I give a quick introduction, they will have a 1 to 2 minute opportunity to speak, and after each of the panelists is gone, we'll go into some questions that we've already discussed beforehand, and we'll get through those. For the panel, as I ask the question, you answer that, and then the rest of the panelists will have an opportunity, if they'd like, to either add on to that discussion, to that question, or add on, and then we'll go out to the floor for 1 to 2 questions if possible. If not, we'll just move on to the next. If we don't get to your question, I promise we will at the end. We'll save a little bit of time at the end for floor Q&A, and I would ask when we do that that you stand up, introduce yourself, and make sure you direct your question if it's at a particular member on the panel or if it's just for general use. Let me introduce the esteemed panel that we have here today. First, we have Rear Admiral Jeffrey Hughes, who is the commander of Navy Recruiting Command. He's a career naval aviator that has served in command at the squadron, wing, and flag levels. Admiral Hughes assumed the duties as 21st commander of the Navy Recruiting Command in September 2015. He leads a people-first focused team responsible for the national recruitment of men and women for officer and enlisted programs in the regular and reserve components of the United States Navy. Admiral Hughes is dedicated to improving the lives of our recruiting force as they aspire to be the undisputed talent acquisition leader in the DoD sector. Ladies and gentlemen, Rear Admiral Jeffrey Hughes.
All right. Thanks, Master Chief. Is this hot? Warm? How about now? All right. All right, well, thanks again, Master Chief, and good afternoon to all of you. I want to thank the Navy League for allowing us to speak on this incredibly important topic. And lastly, I want to thank everybody here. So either you're hanging out because happy hour is going to be starting pretty soon, but honestly, it's good to have you here because, again, I don't think any of us would dispute the fact that this is an incredibly important topic to each and every one of us. So listening to the Chiefs on Monday morning as they kicked off, and we talked about a lot of things, talked about some acquisition-related topics, a lot of geopolitical-type topics, but at the end, everything kind of came back around to our people, and that is the distinct competitive advantage that we enjoy today, and we're going to work very hard across the manpower, personnel, and training and education realm in all of the sea services to make sure that we maintain and keep that competitive edge where it is and where it needs to be in the future. Quick fix on where we are with the Navy. We, by any objective measurement at this point in time, are bringing in the highest quality people, officers and sailors, that we've ever brought in the history of the United States Navy. We are in a great position. However, I will tell you that from my perch over the last 8 months, I see headwinds on the horizon. From a resourcing perspective, pretty crystal clear and a constant theme that you're going to hear in this building throughout the course of this convention, that the declining top line is going to really make things much more pressurized for us as we have very tough choices ahead with investment in procurement, modernization, readiness, and then certainly what we want to do to modernize our weapon system, which is the people that we have in our services. Requirements. So we're almost a victim of our own success in that the fleet demands the quality of sailors that we're bringing in right now. That's the expectation. And frankly, in emerging areas of new growth, in warfare areas that we have to really get better at as we go forward, such as information dominance, information warfare, cyber, electromagnetic warfare, we need to bring in even better people, and that is a growth requirement. So resources coming down, requirements growing up. The third component is what's the market going to look like? And that's pretty vexing right now. I would say that over the last 15 years, we've enjoyed a very favorable recruiting market. All indications right now, if you look at the unemployment rate and the youth unemployment rate, is that we should start to experience some really tough times here in the near future. The economy is still a little sluggish, so we're still enjoying some pretty good benefits, but we've got to be prepared for when that eventuality happens, and it will happen probably over the course of the next year, year and a half, 2 years. So what are we doing about it? Again, the chief said on this one, we've got to change, we've got to adapt, we've got to be ready. We have to control what we can control as we evolve and control and focus that evolution in the areas that move the needle for us in our critical area. A couple reasons why we have to change. We can't afford the status quo. We can't afford to recruit and train and do the retention piece the way that we've done it in the past. So we've got to get smarter about our processes and make sure that we're doing things as effectively and efficiently as we possibly can. The other piece of this is that the talent market is changing. We'll talk, and hopefully you'll ask some questions on our perspective on the millennials, the Generation Y folks. It's a different group that we're really trying to understand and uncover. And frankly, we're starting to merge into Generation Z or whatever the what's next. So we really need to make sure that we're changing and adapting to be effective in that talent pool that we're looking at here over the course of the next 10 to 15 years. And then lastly, we need to take advantage of the changes in the information flow that exist, in the different means of people gaining information about what it is we do. How do we tell our story in a saturated market? How can we move the needle so that at the end of the day, we can put our incredibly talented recruiters out there on the bag and make a difference and help people that are sitting on the fence make the decision to join the greatest Navy in the history of the world. Thanks.
Thank you, Admiral. Next, we have Master Chief April Beldo, who is the Fleet Master Chief of Manpower, Personnel, Training, and Education. The mission of MPT&E is distribution and administration of naval personnel to meet quantitative and qualitative manpower requirements and execute career development, training, and education policies. Fleet Beldo provides advice to the Chief of Naval Personnel Deputy, Chief of Naval Operations, on matters and policies of interest affecting 400,000 active and reserve sailors throughout the Navy. Additionally, she maintains close liaison with the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Navy, ensuring effective communications to and from the fleet. Ladies and gentlemen, Fleet Master Chief April Beldo.
Good afternoon. And again, thank you all for being here this afternoon. As Admiral Hughes talked about, we both work for Admiral Moran, and one of our responsibilities is not only recruiting, but it's training, it's making sure we distribute those personnel where they need to be, when they need to be there with the right training, and then after they continue their career, making sure they have what they need to either stay, or if they choose to transition, help them transition. My responsibility as a senior enlisted leader for Admiral Moran is to make sure that I'm out and about in the fleet, talking to those sailors and making sure that we are able to provide those particular customer service, that's what I call them, customer service areas that we need to. So I'm Admiral Hughes' wingman today. So all those questions that pertain to not only recruiting, training, and maintaining, and then retaining, we'll answer together. So I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Fleet. Next, we have Rear Admiral Bill Kelly, who is the Coast Guard's Assistant Commandant for Human Resources. He is responsible for implementing the vision for human capital management to recruit, develop, and retain a diverse, proficient, and effective workforce to meet the current and future needs of the service's nearly 60,000 member active duty, reserve, and civilian workforce. Admiral Kelly oversees the Coast Guard's human resources field activities, health, safety, and work-life programs, sexual assault prevention and response victim support program, and leadership and diversity initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen, Rear Admiral Bill Kelly.
Thank you, Master Chief. And as Master Chief said, we're going to take about a minute or two here today to just give you an update. But Master Chief, I've only been in the job 29 days, so thank you for just kind of covering some of the things I didn't even know I was responsible for. I appreciate that. And my two shipmates to the left, Admiral Hughes and Master Chief, already hit on many of the same issues that are impacting us in the United States Coast Guard. So again, thanks to my Navy shipmates for covering many of the things that I was preparing to cover. I want to thank the Navy League and all of our sponsors for the opportunity to be here today. I've had the opportunity to grow up both in the surface fleet and also in the HR world, in the training world, the performance world, and the personnel world. And I can't think of a better task to wake up day in and day out than to be caring about the men and women of our great service. Whether it's the active duty, the reserve, are our civil servants who show up for work every day committed to protecting and defending our nation. It's a noble profession. It's a great job. And as Admiral Hughes just touched on briefly, I had the opportunity to sit in on a brief today with the Commandant, and we went around the room. There was only seven or eight of us in the room, and I would say 60 to 70% of the issues that the Commandant was being briefed on this morning were personnel issues, starting with transgender and working down from there. So people are an important topic, clearly I believe the most important topic. May not be the glitziest one to talk about, but the most important one. And we'll talk more about that and look forward to your questions and the opportunity to comment and also the opportunity to learn sitting up here among so many great shipmates today. Thank you.
Thanks, Admiral. Next, we have Brigadier General James Bierman, who is the Commanding General of Marine Corps Recruit Depot San Diego and the Western Recruiting Region. Over 21,000 recruits train at Recruit Depot San Diego every year, and over 1 million have trained there since MCRD San Diego's inception. Western Recruiting Region is responsible for recruiting quality men and women west of the Mississippi River to serve as U.S. Marines to embody the Marine Corps' core values, honor, courage, and commitment. Ladies and gentlemen, Brigadier General Bierman.
Thank you for the intro, and great to be here with all of you. I'll start by just making teasing out something that was that came out in the bio. As the commanding general of MCRD San Diego, I'm also the commanding general of the Western Recruiting Region. And in the Marine Corps, that's deliberate. We believe that the unity of command, of having one commander who's responsible for both the recruiting and the recruit training, that forces accountability throughout the entire system. One of our previous comments, General Barrow, when he combined recruiting and recruit training under the same general, his comment was, you know, recruiting station commanders don't send their bosses bad recruits. So whether I actually have responsibility for recruiting and recruit training west of the Mississippi, and then my counterpart at MCRD Paris Island has responsibility for recruiting and recruit training east of the Mississippi River. We believe in the Marine Corps that recruiting and recruit training are inextricably linked, and we believe that the entirety of the entry-level pipeline is inextricably linked to our success in combat and our ability to be the nation's force in readiness. I'll tell you all that recruiting and recruit training in the Marine Corps are critically important. Now, some of you may be saying, okay, I got that. Anybody on the panel could say that. Frankly, so could anybody leading any high-tempo civilian organization. You know, the ability to recruit good people, to train them the right way, that's important to everybody. And I acknowledge that point, but I'll also say recruiting and recruit training are uniquely critical to the United States Marine Corps. And I'll back up that statement with 2 points. The first thing I will tell you all is in the Marine Corps, we are uniquely a people organization. What has always distinguished us is the individual Marine. It's always been that way. It's always going to be that way. And I would say in today's operating environment, it's more important than it's ever been. The other point I'll make is one of the things that distinguishes the United States Marine Corps is we are the youngest of all the services, and we have the highest turnover. A couple data points on that. On October 1st of this year, we'll come down to 182,000 active duty United States Marines. Of that 182,000, 75% of all those Marines are first-term Marines. 145,000 of those Marines are in the grade of sergeant and below. Every year in the Marine Corps, we turn over between 35 and 40,000 Marines. And when you think about, you know, why the American people pay our bills of four deployed force in readiness, those are staggering numbers to reflect on the fact that 20 to 25% of the Marine Corps turns over on an annual basis. Hopefully they go on to leave the Marine Corps, be better citizens, but it's a zero-sum game. They've got to be replaced with the right young men and women, the right numbers, the right quality. The Marine Corps machine is highly efficient, but it's also fragile, and it depends on those numbers coming in on time, in the right quality, and in the right way. We remain successful. We don't take that for granted at all. I certainly agree with Admiral Hughes' comment that there are a lot of indicators that the recruiting environment is going to continue to be It's going to get even more challenging than it is. But I would just point out of all the things I could mention to three pillars of our success in the Marine Corps on the recruiting side. The first is the institutional commitment of our senior leadership. A lot of people are just amazed when I mention the fact in the Marine Corps, plus or minus about 80 general officers, about a quarter of them have served in recruiting. With 59 sergeants major on recruiting, we have more sergeants major doing recruiting than in any other command in the Marine Corps. Secondly, the quality of the Marines that we're sending to recruiting duty and to BDIs, our very, very best NCOs, staff NCOs, and officers. We can't afford to do it any other way. We have to send our best and expect them to recruit in their own image. And the last thing I would mention is the timelessness of our brand. We still don't promise a rose garden. We still throw a challenge out there. If you can meet our standards and our expectations, maybe you can be a Marine. And then the last thing I'll say is one of our previous commandants said, we do two things at the end of the day for the country in the United States Marine Corps. We win our nation's battles, and we make Marines. Well, you just can't do the first unless you get the second right. And so that remains a point of high emphasis in our institution. Thank you.
Thank you, General. Next, we have Sergeant Major Ron Green, who is the 18th Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps, having assumed the post in February 2015. He is the senior enlisted advisor to the Commandant of the Marine Corps. He's been deployed to Somalia with the 13th Marine Expeditionary Unit during Operation Restore Hope. He's deployed to South America in support of Operation United Americas in 2002 and with the Marine Light Attack Helicopter Squadron in support of Operation Iraqi Freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, Sergeant Major Green.
Hey, thanks, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon. On behalf of the entire Marine Corps, the 34,000 that are forward deployed, 184,000 on active duty, 38,500 reserve Marines we have, I want to thank you for showing up today and showing interest in this conversation. I don't have a lot to say to start off because what General Bierman just said is the conversation of the Marine Corps. I don't need to repeat that. I represent all 85% of the Marines that wear flat black on their collar. I'm proud to be here, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thanks, Sergeant Major. Finally, we have Mr. John Thackrah, who is the Executive Director of the Navy's Military Sealift Command. Military Sealift Command is a leading provider of ocean transportation for the Navy and the rest of the Department of Defense, operating approximately 115 ships daily around the world. Military Sealift Command operates ships that support five mission areas: combat logistics, command and service support, special mission, pre-positioning, and sealift. Mr. Thackrah is responsible for providing legal and business advice on the full spectrum of issues at Military Sealift Command. From November 2007 to July 2008, he served as Acting Assistant Secretary of the Navy, Research, Development, and Acquisition. In February 2011, he became Executive Director of the Military Sealift Command. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. John Thackrah.
Master Chief, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Good afternoon, everyone. And in case you were wondering, yes, I am intimidated sitting up here as the only guy with a tie on with all of these distinguished officers here with me. But I am proud to be here with all of you, so thank you for the opportunity. So you're probably wondering why this guy is up here in civilian clothes. Well, I work for Military Sealift Command. We are a largely civilian organization. We hire and train and recruit 5,900 civil service mariners to drive our ships every day. We are a commercial shipping company buried inside the United States Navy. So what do we have to do? We have to do the same thing that these officers have to do, except instead of going to the street or schools or anywhere else that they go, I go to U.S. Merchant Marine Academy, I go to six state academies to get our officers, or I go out to the street to get our able-bodied seamen to come aboard our ships. These ships, these officers that we recruit and train are driving everything from 106,000-ton USNS Puller, which is our brand new float-forward staging base ship, all the way down to, you know, working in the engine room of one of our new expeditionary fast transport ships. We do our own recruiting inside of MSC. We don't use the Navy Militant recruiting facilities. So we have our own mini BUPERS, if you will, inside, and so we have to manage all of that and the training and everything that goes along with it. As I said before, we are a commercial shipping company. We use a commercial shipping model. And along with what Master Chief commented on about the five service areas that we use, that we provide, along with that, I will remind all of us that we have 43 separate classes of ships that we operate. And to find the right masters, the right able-bodied seamen, and the right individuals to drive those ships every day is a huge challenge for us. So we're facing a lot of the same issues that some of the folks up and down this table are every day. I look forward to your questions. Thanks again, Master Chief.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we're going to get right into it with some questions for the panel. And as I asked a question for the panel, in no certain order, just whoever wants to roger up and answer it, please just do that. And we'll give each panelist an opportunity to answer the question. First, there's a lot of emphasis is being placed on the future of our force and their readiness. What initiatives are each of your components working on to innovate the recruiting process, and how have you altered your methods to attract today's youth to military service?
I'll take a stab first. The first thing is, and I'm not going to dodge a question at all, but I would reiterate the fact that, you know, we have a timeless formula in the Marine Corps that works very well for us. We take the very best Marines, regardless of their MOS, their job specialty, and we send them to be DIs and we send them to be recruiters. They throw that challenge out, they recruit in their own image, and then we take some of the very best Marines to transform them, these young men and women, into Marines at boot camp. That's not ever going to change, and for the reasons I've already described, that's an institutional imperative. I would mention a couple things, though, that I think are recent innovations or changes. The first thing I would say is, more aggressively than any time in the 29 years I've been in a Marine, and certainly in the last 3 years I've been a commander on recruiting, we are aggressively going after quality females right now in the Marine Corps. We have 14,000 female Marines in our Corps today. We could not be more proud of them. But to this point, because we have the smallest number of females of any of the other services, plus or minus 5, 6, 7% as you move through the years, we've been in a little bit of a position to where we oftentimes didn't need to go after them as aggressively as we did sometimes the men. We had a little bit of an attitude of those quality females will come to us, and indeed that was often the case. However, recently, we have changed our entire system and focused on going after the quality females. In terms of the advertising, in terms of the mail outs, in terms of the components of systematic recruiting, we are doing everything in our power to have the conversation with the quality females that are out there about being United States Marines. In the fall of this year, we're going to begin shipping females to previously closed ground combat MOSs. We want to make sure we are selling those jobs effectively the right way, and we want to make sure we're sparing no effort to find young women who want to do it and can meet the very tough upfront requirements. We want to make sure that we're picking and choosing from among the very best that are out there. And then the other thing I would mention, and I suspect that, you know, we've all experienced this on the panel, while our message has not changed and our approach has not changed, we constantly have to evolve how we talk to and connect with young people. We have to keep taking a look at how they view and use social media, and it's amazing the degree to which it changes. I have 5 kids, 2 in college, 3 in high school, and just last week they were laughing at me like, you know, Dad still thinks it's okay to send emails. I mean, I almost can't keep up with the way they communicate, their emphasis being on the texting. So we're constantly reassessing, you know, how are we communicating with and messaging the young men and women that are out there to make sure that it's in a relevant web-based way. We got a great partner, our 70-year partnership with J. Walter Thompson that keeps us honest. So those are 2 things that I would touch on.
Hey, thanks, Master Chief. I'm going to echo a number of the comments that General Bierman brought up. I think it's important to not throw the baby out with the bathwater. We're obviously all very successful in what we're doing. Just look at who we have in service today. So there's an awful lot that we want to maintain. But I will tell you, again, trying to control, I don't want those external factors and forces to drive us to an area where we're not going to be as capable going forward. So we've got to evolve in pace. And I'll jump on the area. You know, first and foremost, You know, the beginning of this question was about readiness, and I would say that all of us on this panel think in terms of this is all about what it takes to win. We got to remember that. While we may be competing with the private sector, we, at the end of the day, really need to make sure that we're bringing in the right talent to ensure that we're going to maintain that competitive advantage against potential adversaries now and in the future. So a couple things is the connection with that talent and how do we reach them. So certainly evolving through things like, you know, just getting in the medium where we're actually penetrating and getting out there. One of the hard parts is just how much information exists in the market today. It's overwhelming. So how do we take our great narrative, the great story, the things that attracted us, and again, putting, you know, representative folks, the very best of our services out on the bag to go out there and actively convince those to come take this journey with us, that's critical. So much like the Marine Corps, we are, well, actually a little bit different than Marine Corps in that they've had a long-standing relationship with a marketing and advertising agency for some time that have done just phenomenal work and frankly are the benchmark for all of us to find. We just signed on for a new contract, and I will tell you, it gives us an opportunity to really get after where this market is going, how it's evolving, and how we can be more effective across the board in every aspect and how we really go out and reach those folks. But I'd also say we also have a great message in that we're putting in place some of these Sailor 2025 initiatives, things that are going to make the military look more attractive to this generation, to the millennials, things that are going to help them. They're different than the Gen Xers, than the boomers that are in the senior ranks and certainly us up on this table right now. So having a better story that we can actually get out there is certainly going to be helpful. I would also say it's important for us, just a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago, our recruiters were out in the field with flip phones. So we're out there trying to show that this very tech-savvy client base, that we're out there, here we are, the Ford-class nuclear aircraft carrier, the F-35 B and C Joint Strike Fighter, DDG 1000, and we're still on the flip phone. We lose a lot of credibility right there. So you know what? We're on the iPhone 5. And frankly, we're enabling our recruiters to do something that's even more important, in my humble opinion, which is in this favorable market that we've had over the last 15 years, I think we've gotten a little too passive. So we're getting active. We're getting mobile. When we're taking this mobile technology that will resonate better with the folks that we're trying to attract to come into the service, and we're connecting with them to the point where why shouldn't we be able to do a completely paperless application, much like you would to apply Common App for a college admissions process or to get a home loan or a mortgage? I mean, we need to have that same level of customer service. They expect that, and frankly, we need to get there, and we're getting there, and that's going to really help us turn the corner. Lastly, I'd say we're starting to dabble a little bit more now with virtual recruiting in general. When you start talking about this pressurization in the top line and us having to be smarter with the resources that we have, we're putting the resources where the market bears out where the talent is. Because again, it's not just about volume, it's about high quality. We need high quality to be successful in that fight of the future. So we're putting the ground game where it moves the needle the most. However, it's giving us an opportunity to look at how we can best employ our virtual recruiting to get after some of those areas that maybe we vacated, but also to kind of help get into that medium where we might be able to complete the majority of that transaction from prospecting through the actual convincing someone to come over the line and hire them, as well as to help with the onboarding process to make sure that they're as successful as they show up at the front door of Recruit Training Command or up at OCS, ODS in Newport to make that happen. So kind of a lot of different things out there. At the end of the day, we're trying to make sure that we're making it such that we understand the medium they're operating in and we're attracting them based on how we're operating that medium, and that we're changing the process where we need to be more effective and efficient in the tough times that are ahead.
Master Chief, I mentioned that General Bierman, how much there's similarity across all the services. I like to say that we're about an order of magnitude one or two zeros below what the Navy, Marine Corps, or our brothers and sisters in the Army, the Air Force, when we talk about recruiting. A couple years ago, we made the decision to reduce our recruiting workforce by about 25%. We're hurting because of that right now. We're in a stern chase with regards to recruiting the workforce of the future. So with that, the Coast Guard is hiring. GoCoastGuard.com. For any of you out there who are anyone who might have be propensed to serve in the United States military, I believe our brand is phenomenal, and we're looking to hire some good young men and women. So we're in a stern chase. We're down to 55 recruiting offices across the country, and as Admiral Hughes just talked about, we need to figure out how to be relevant across the country. We recruit along the coasts, which would make sense for the United States Coast Guard, but we recognize we're missing out on a large cohort of men and women, and a diverse cohort of men and women across the heartland of this country who have the attributes to serve in the United States military. And we have to figure out how to be mobile, how to reach out to them, and I really appreciate your comments on paperless. We're working to get there because we were right where you were at. Mm-hmm. You know, the flip phones 2 and 3 years ago, and not if you can't go out with an iPad and show a young man or woman, what you're going to be able to do and what they're going to be able to do in the United States Coast Guard, they're moving on to the next booth and not going to be spending the time with us. We have a great brand. So in places like Boston, places like Chesapeake, Virginia, places like L.A., places like San Francisco, we have no problems recruiting. That's a place where the Coast Guard has strong brand recognition. And quite frankly, other than Chesapeake, we're probably pretty front and center from a military perspective in those locales. So you can't really, other than Old Ironside up in Boston, there's not much going on from a Navy perspective. So the Coast Guard's the big player in that arena, and we do great up there. We got to figure out how to take that brand recognition and be able to translate that elsewhere throughout the country to be able to attract those young men and women, because our recruiting mission has doubled in the past 3 years, and we're in the hurt locker right now. We are in a clear stern chase, so we're looking to learn. I'm looking to learn up here, but also to learn and to engage with the folks who are in the audience about what we can do to potentially find those force multipliers so that we can recruit the future of the United States Coast Guard. Thanks, Master Chief.
Master Chief, just a short comment. We're in a civilian recruiting mode, slightly different, but about the same. And what we find is that we've created a list, flexible work schedules, more leave without pay opportunities, tuition assistance, intermittent or work mixed work life schedule, use of mobile devices, financial incentives for licensed officers, tuition assistance, tuition reimbursement, opportunities to go to graduate school at the Naval War College. That brings us to the starting line, because that's what all the corporate guys are giving them. Because when our mariners graduate from one of the six state maritime academies, if we don't offer them that, some commercial shipping company will, or some oil driller in the Gulf of Mexico will offer them that. So that's where we set the bar, and then we have to move forward from there. So it's a similar but slightly different challenge that we're facing.
Sergeant Major, Fleet, the Admiral General, do okay?
I think they hit on everything for the Navy. I'll speak for
Sergeant Major.
We can move on to the next.
Okay, I'd like to open up for a couple questions from the floor, if there are any at this time.
Good afternoon, Lieutenant Colonel Sanchez from the Dutch Marines. I've got a question for Sergeant Major Green and probably also for Fleet Master Chief Beldo. We're talking about recruiting, training, but retaining. Changes are hard, especially cultural changes are even harder. We're talking about a big majority of older enlisted and officers, of course, also, who are actually feeling comfortable in their comfort zone. And talking about changing, I think this is the part we really need to convince and really need to support a change if we're talking about changing an organization. How does the Navy, but also especially for me, the Marines, how do we work on that? And do we have plans to actually drag those persons in and help let them help with making changes? Is my question clear, or?
It's pretty clear. I'm trying to figure out who you're talking about dragging in. That's the question.
Have I seen with the Dutch Marines? If we're talking, we just changed in 2013. We actually changed our complete organization. If you're talking about the companies, the sections, or things like that, and what we actually show is that the older NCOs are hard to convince of changing. those are the guys we really need, you know, to force and help us out with changing. So my question actually is, do you see the same problems with all the big changes which are coming up, especially talking about technology? Our whiz kids which are coming in right now are used to it. We are not. I'm not. And do you have plans for, okay, how do we implement this, and how do we actually take them with us on the path of change?
I understand. Change for the older generation, it's been the same all the time. For any older generation, change is hard. This is not something new that we're doing. Of course it's hard. The biggest difference today from when I came in 33 years ago and the Sergeant Major of the Marine Corps is technology. It's technology. It's trying to keep up with the youth globally. When General Bierman talked about, you know, all the texting and the emailing and all of that, that's where we seem to suffer as an older generation. No other generation, I don't think any other generation has faced this type of global change at such a rapid pace. Between the computer and the eye and, you know, everything else out there, I mean, information travels instantaneously around the world. That means the enemy has the same capability on the iPhone that the United States Department of Defense has. And we need to understand that. It's not just the youth here in America. It's the youth movement has happened around the world. You look at Egypt, you look at Tunisia, all those were youth movements. That's revolutionary. It has been going on probably since human beings have been on Earth. That's just the way it is. Eventually, the old will go out, the new will become old, and the clock starts again. But as far as the Marine Corps is concerned, it's where we start. We start selling the same product every day. We don't change the product we're looking for. An opportunity to be something better than self, to be a part of a team that goes out every day and tries, or not try, but make sure that we assure this nation freedom and security. That's what the United States Marine Corps does. In 1952, the 82nd Congress told the Marine Corps, you ought to be a force in readiness. You ought to be most ready when the nation's least ready. We wake up with that mission every day. 24 infantry battalions. 24. Those are the individuals that everything else in the Marine Corps supports. Everything they do, everything they carry to combat is on their back. It's on their back. That hadn't changed. That won't change tomorrow until we can get something like Ripley and Alien, or, you know, what's the other movie? What's the one? Avatar. Until we can invent something, you know, some exoskeletons that's going to carry what we call in the book the soldier's load or the Marine's load, it's going to be on their back. Those are the people we have to recruit, male or female. If you can carry it, if you can do what the Marine Corps standards say are required of you, you can do the job. We just opened up the last 6 MOSs that have always been restricted to female Marines. They're wide open. They're wide open. No one's beating down the door. Our female Marines are not beating down the door to carry 100-some pounds on their backs. But for the ones that can do it, they're absolutely invited to come and join the team, the infantry team. Everything else supports that Marine Air Ground Task Force. So when you say change, understand the people we recruit, they either, you know, they go out and they change minds or they change zip codes. That's what we do. I don't care how much technology, I don't care how much, you know, you talk about people, recruiting people, this. Yeah, we have MOSs for that. But the basis of what we do is locate, close with, and destroy the enemy by fire and maneuver, or repel the enemy's assault by fire and close combat. That's the United States Marine Corps. That's the mission we were given by Congress. And the 114th Congress reminded us of that a few years ago. I get to go up and testify on the quality of life, not just the ones who wear the flat black, but the entire Marine Corps. I get the change. I got it. Somebody's got to kick the door down and find out whether they're enemy or their friend. Somebody's got to be here when they come home, when they need prosthetics. The millions of veterans out there. A lot of people talking about technology. I get paid to meet where human and technology, that crossroad, that's what I care about. That's what I care about. I care more about the people than I care about the technology. I get it. We got to pace. We got to stand pace. We got to outpace our enemy. I got it. But the individual we recruit is most important to me. We will make the change, such as integration. We will make that change and offer those MOSs as we have to everyone. To everyone. And if they fit, if they can pass the standard, whoever they are, we invite them to be on the team. I hope that answers your question.
Hey, I just want to say, if that answer didn't make you want to run 10 miles and punch something, you need to check your pulse.
Right, time for one more, then we'll move on. More question?
Hi.
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm hearing the Navy and the Marine Corps express interest in recruiting better educated recruits, more technical skills, and notwithstanding the Sergeant Major's comments, I was just curious to hear from both sides what the benchmarks of success will be there and what the goals are. And then I know the Marine Corps has expressed some interest in non-cognitive testing to get at that retaining element of recruitment. And I wanted to hear how that's going, if there are any findings, and if the Navy is considering anything similar.
If I could talk to the, I think you talked about the benchmarks with regards to recruiting women. And is that what your point was, or technical ratings? Well, what I will share with as far as the Navy and recruiting, and Admiral Hughes to help me out on this one, I don't think we have a benchmark per se. Our goal is to make sure that we as an organization are reaching out and we are able to tap into the talent in those technical ratings as much as we possibly can. So there's no more than or no less than. We're just, in our mind, when we go out to recruit those young men and women, we want the best of the best along with our other services, I do believe. You know, whoever comes through the door, if they meet the standard as far as Sergeant Major Green talked about, we're going to ask them to be a part of our team. Now, we're always looking for certain areas and specialties, as all of us do, but there's no benchmark that I can think of, sir. I don't recall us having a benchmark.
If I could, I'd just say that we have a demand signal from the fleet. So the fleet tells us exactly what it is they need to operate and to be effective in employing these combat necessary weapon systems, both as operators as well as technicians, to make sure that we can maintain them so that they're up and ready when we need them. So we then, on the recruiting side, we see what is that demand signal on the people chain management front, and then we go out there and we find those people. So we have a very precise fit that plugs into the front end. And if you get that right, then you're more likely to get the rest of it right. So we're going to get the right trained, the right equipped people to that platform to integrate into whatever that combat package may be, a carrier strike group, an expeditionary strike group, what have you, so they can go out there and do the mission. So we do obviously look to see what the quality metrics are to support that precise fit. And again, as I mentioned in the intro, by all objective standards and measures, academic aptitude, number of high school diploma graduates, things along those lines. We've never had higher numbers of statistics that we had in the past.
If I could just make one comment, ma'am. You said something about more educated and more talented individuals. We just fought for 14 years. 14 years of fighting. Education, talent look pretty freaking good on the battlefield. I'm just asking, I mean, I don't understand the caliber. This is America. We represent the people of America at all educational levels, up and down the chain. We got nuclear, you know, submarines, F-35 Joint Strike Fighters, but we have infantrymen, we have cooks, you know, we have supply, we've got artillery. We represent the finest in America. The less than 1% that'll put on a uniform and defend this nation. We have talent. and we have education. We educate from your the homes you live in. That's what we were given. That's what we educate. I mean, that's what we recruit from.
Yeah, and I'll dovetail a little bit on that great point by the Sergeant Major. We are we're getting an extraordinary product right now. The ASVAB scores, the rate of high school completion, the amount of time they spend in the delayed entry program, it's higher than it's ever been. I'm always very, very hesitant, though, about saying things like better than it's ever been in the history of the Marine Corps. I mean, who are you comparing the kids nowadays to the Marines who landed on Iwo Jima, who marched out of the Chosin Reservoir? So I would firmly say as good. At the same time, you know, we need to make sure, and we talk about this a lot in the Marine Corps, we can't get mesmerized by the glittering educational statistics, the ASVAB scores, and we've got to make sure we stay focused on the whole person concept. One thing we're doing right now in the Marine Corps is we're having a very good and useful dialogue, particularly with some of the federal services, to increase our ability to do mental health screening up front. We've introduced some new tests that they're called the Omaha 5 and TAPIST to make sure that, you know, in addition to the great education, the great intelligence scores, we're getting young men and women who are mentally healthy. The other thing I would mention too is, you know, we need to make sure we keep the main thing, and that's coming back to what I said about the whole person concept. We not only need kids who are smart, who are high school graduates, we need young men and women who are mentally, morally, and physically tough, who can take a punch. You know, I was giving the precept to one of our boards where we were selecting officer candidates, and I said to the board, look, you know, if I got a kid and really some of the stats are this good now, if I got a kid with a 3.5, president of his fraternity, Eagle Scout, lettered in a sport, but he's been on the sweet side of the curve his entire life, and the first time, you know, his platoon sergeant at OCS tells him he did something wrong, he kind of folds like a cheap suit because nobody's ever talked to him that way. Is that the one I want, or do I want the kid with a few tenths of a point less GPA, who put himself through college, who's had some adversity in his life, who's overcome some obstacles, and is mentally and physically tough? Because that's what he's going to be required to endure in combat. And as he becomes a mentor and a leader to young Marines, you know, he's going to need to talk them through their problems. Now, ideally, I'm like every other senior leader in the military. I want it all. I want both things. But you know, as much as we pat ourselves on the back for the great statistics, you know, we got to also remind ourselves in the Marine Corps, we're not necessarily looking for a kid who is home playing chess on Saturday night. We're looking for a smart, dedicated kid who's got some physicality and can overcome adversity and pushes or her way through tough situations.
Okay. I don't want to call a quick audible. I'm just going to get through the questions for the panel, and then we'll save the last bit of time for Q&A from the floor. First question I have is for Admiral. Are you plans to innovate and update the professional or technical training of recruits at basic training and of sailors throughout their naval careers?
So in the essence of time, I won't drone on too much here. I will tell you we just rolled out a design for maintaining maritime superiority, and one of the key lines of effort for us is to achieve high velocity learning at every level. So one of the things that we're trying to do is to better deliver the right training to people at the right time. So we call it ready relevant learning. And what I'll do, instead of tell you what it is, I'll give you an example. So right now, we may bring in one of these, you know, physically, morally, mentally fantastic future sailors through our DEP into Recruit Training Command, get them up to the baseline of our expectation, then we'll send them on to their in-rate training. A lot of times, we bring them through that training in the technical rating area, and a lot of times, it can take a pretty large amount of time. That's time that they're not getting out to the fleet. We also have a tendency to give them too much training up front. They may go through what we call the A school, which is the initial, and then get into a more graduate level C school. So by the time they get out to the fleet, they've taken all this education, but they really haven't had a whole lot of practical experience. We think that it's better for them to learn faster by shortening those learning cycles. Let's get them through RTC, get them what they need so they can be effective sailors. Then build on that, get them into that rate training. What do they need to do in the fleet as an operator or as a technician? And give them just enough that they can be effective then when they get their hands on that equipment, and then they're working with those that have the experience out in the fleet. And then we'll continually revisit that periodically. It's a continuum of learning that's going to last throughout their entire career so that we continue to give that to them all along. It's very akin to what I've grown up with in naval aviation, in that early on, they teach you how to fly the aircraft and then how to fight the weapon system. But you get kind of a undergraduate level, and then you'll learn through your first squadron tour, and you continue to progress with your qualifications. You get more tactically capable. But then you start getting into more and more of you're learning how to not only lead your particular, you know, be effective as the aircraft commander in your particular aircraft. Now you're, how am I going to do it with a section? How am I going to do it with a division of aircraft? How do I continue to expand? And you bring that up over the course of time. So you're kind of merging some of those other considerations into that individual learning. We believe that that's going to be more effective on a number of fronts, and so we're going to roll that out, and we're pretty excited about what's going to bear out.
Thanks, sir. Next question for Admiral Kelly. Admiral, the Commandant of the Coast Guard recently signed the Human Capital Strategy. Can you briefly explain how the Coast Guard plans to use this strategy to recruit, train, and retain an effective workforce of the future?
Sure can, Master Chief. Thank you. So on January 7th, the Commandant signed a Human Capital Strategy. It was the first time in our service's history where our senior leader put down in paper the strategy for moving forward with regards to our people. And the strategy is a 10-year strategy, so it's not the next 720 days of his administration in the next 2 years that he serves as Commandant, but it's designed to put a mark down in the sand and last us for the next decade. And he did this because we've focused a lot over the past couple years on recapitalizing our fleet, and we're currently recapitalizing our IT infrastructure and many other of our systems. But he recognized, and I think we recognize, that people are at the foundation of that. So by putting the human capital strategy in place, it puts a marker down. And I like to go back to an old master chief who told me what the boss finds interesting, others will find fascinating. And by the fact that the Commandant finds this interesting, it's proven that others find it fascinating. So with that comes attention, with that comes resources, with that comes focus on the appropriate resource, our people. So the desire to really break it down is to recruit, to train and retain the best men and women that we can to serve the nation, both on the active, the reserve, and the civil servant side of the house. And our goal and our desire is to put the right people in the right place at the right time with the right tools to accomplish Coast Guard missions for our nation. And so the human capital strategy doesn't get very tactical, but provides us the guidance and the oversight and really the framework to move forward with that. So that's really where the human capital strategy is coming out. We're what, 4 months into it, 5 months into it, gaining some great traction. And again, it was the right stroke by our boss to say, hey, you know what, people are important. We're going to stop saying it, and we're going to put a marker down in the sand and hold people accountable to it. So it's a great tool for us working forward, and especially in the human resources world, it's a great tool to have at your disposal to lay out the framework and the guidelines and the track lines going forward.
Thank you, sir. Next question is for Fleet Beldo. Master Chief, it looks like the Navy is experiencing an environment of extremely high retention. When it changes, and we all know that it will, what plan is the Navy working on right now to mitigate any alarming decrease in your retention levels?
Well, I think Admiral Hughes, we talked about the recruiting piece of it, and with regards to some of the initiatives that we have to be more efficient and more effective, and then again to be more innovative as we go out and talk to our young prospective young men and women that want to join the Navy. But I think also with that comes along this program we have in the Navy called Sailor 2025, and what we're doing is we are looking down the road, and because we know that we cannot continue to recruit, train and retain our young men and women the way we do today. So there are some initiatives for us to have a better information technology backbone. For instance, again, here we go, talk about technology. Right now, our sailors can't talk, you know, like they're used to talking at home. You know, they have the iPads, they have their iPhones, they do a lot of texting like General already talked about, but then they come in the boot camp and then we give them a 550-page training guide and a pencil. So what we do is we have this initiative right now called eSailor that we're piloting in boot camp, and we're distributing each of our recruits a tablet, and we're putting the information that they need to use for over the next 9 weeks to become a sailor on that tablet. And they don't have to be in a classroom. It's not all brick and mortar. After they finish in the classroom throughout the day, they can go back during night study and they can do repetitions of anything that they've learned during that day, whether that was folding and stowing, which has to do with attention to detail, whether that was live fire range or any type of identification of aircraft or submarines or ships, just something that they can use with applications, vice, again, this handbook and pen. So I think we're appealing, if I could say that, to the generation. However, at the end of that, we need to make sure, and I think that's what Sergeant Major Green was getting at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, one of the things we want to instill with our Navy Corps values of honor, courage, commitment, is the initiative, integrity, accountability, and toughness. And I think that's one of the things that we talked about is toughness. At the end of the day, you came, you joined, because you wanted to do something, be a part of something bigger than yourself, and serve your country. So we're trying to put that all into moving forward as an organization. And I think the Sailor of 2025 will get that. So we're trying to get at that.
Okay. Thanks, Luke. Great stuff. Next question is for General Bierman. Sir, the Marine Corps is the only armed service that conducts gender-segregated vice gender-integrated recruit training. I wanted to ask, why does the Marine Corps continue to think this is the right way to make a Marine, just as the overall Corps becomes increasingly gender-integrated?
Yeah, that's a great question. Thank you. First thing I'll say up front is the Marine Corps is the only service that does same-sex recruit training. The other services are all integrated, and they we respect the way they do business. They turn out terrific soldiers, sailors, airmen, Coast Guardmen, merchant mariners. But I am very glad, because some of you may be aware that our decision to continue with same-sex recruit training has come under fire. I am glad to say some words about it and frankly to defend the way that we conduct entry-level training and boot camp. A couple points up front. While our males and our females do train in separate platoons, series, companies, battalions, I'll tell you that the men and women go to boot camp for exactly the same amount of time. And they go through the exact same program of instruction, no differences whatsoever. Throughout the course of boot camp, the male and female recruits, they actually, about 65% of the time, they come together, same location, same activity, and they train side by side, even though they're training in intact platoons. The other thing I would mention is in the Marine Corps, we have full gender integration in our follow-on combat training, and in our MOS schools. We're the only service that after boot camp, before the Marines report into their MOS schools, we have a separate standalone period of combat training, which we view as part of our entry-level training. So we would say that we integrate near the end of the entry-level training pipeline prior to MOS school in combat training. But it's certainly, I can understand why, at a time where we've all got our marching orders and we've opened up previously closed units and MOSs, we're more fully integrating the military with regard to gender. I can see why somebody would look at the way we look at recruit training and say it's not keeping up with the times. I would say that we not only think the way we do same-sex recruit training is not counter to the end state of a gender-integrated Marine Corps, we think for us it is absolutely the best training. And a couple conversational points here. At the heart of what occurs in Marine Corps boot camp, is the recruits within the platoon living, working, training with each other under tremendous stress in an open squad bay under the watchful eyes of a DI for 12 and a half weeks. That pressure is never off them, and there's never a time where they can walk away from that need to come together as a team. There's two critical relationships that are being developed: the relationship between the recruits and the DIs, and the relationship between the recruits themselves. We are inculcating them with our core values of honor, courage, and commitment, and we are transitioning their mindset from I to we, which is a key factor in winning on the battlefield, putting the mission and the unit above the selfish personal thoughts. And to that end, our experience and our assessment is that this transformation occurs best when we minimize distractions. I don't think anybody would disagree with me when I say young men and women that age can become tremendously distracted. And it's our belief that that transformation, which occurs during a very limited period of 12 weeks, that that's done best when the recruits are focused and they're bringing on board these important lessons. The other thing I'll say is we believe that there's got to be an environment where these recruits are being exposed to strong same-sex male and female role models that they can relate to and immediately strive to emulate. You know, we talked about the great stats, the great young men and women that are coming into the Marine Corps and all the other services. I'll also tell you, and it's sobering, and I'm very big and inspired and bullish on the young men and women joining the military nowadays, but so many of them come from broken families where they either had no male or female role model or they would have been better off without the one they have. So we believe it's critically important in a lot of cases, frankly, DIs are not teaching them, transforming them into Marines. They're teaching them first how to be, you know, principled young men and women before we even step off on the making of Marines part. We believe that our approach to recruit training acknowledges the difference between men and women. We want to maximize physical fitness while reducing injuries. Again, we bring those men and women together in combat training when we've brought both of them up to a certain level of physical fitness, which increases confidence and increases the respect that they have for each other. We believe that our same-sex recruit training model reduces discipline problems, and we think it's also very conducive to an environment where recruits will step forward and talk about pre-existing sexual assaults or harassment that may have occurred in their life. Interesting, over the last 15 years, there have been half a dozen congressional DOD private studies of all the services boot camps. In some cases, they were not predisposed to appreciate or like the way we do business, and they have universally come back with a very positive report card on how we make Marines. So I'll tell you, you know, the decision's been made to integrate the Marine Corps and the entire military. We support that with a happy and willing heart in the Marine Corps, but we don't think it's too much to ask, you know, as these young men and women go on to serve from anywhere from 4 to 40 years, to have a small period of 12 weeks where the transformation occurs, where they can focus on absorbing the right lessons amongst their fellow men or women in an undistracted environment. And so we remain very, very committed to that same-sex recruit training. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Thackrah, the MARAD's Military to Mariners program connects veterans with careers afloat in the U.S. Merchant Marine. How does this program help transitioning service members enter the Merchant Marine or work at Military Sealift Command?
Thanks, Master Chief. The program that was kicked off by the Maritime Administration and has been supported by Military Sealift Command is a great initiative, because sooner or later our enlisted or officer corps members of all of our services eventually decide to transition out. And what we're trying to do is set them up from the day they leave boot camp on a program that can allow them to accumulate sea time, to get credit for the training that they're getting in the eyes of the Coast Guard. So, Master Chief, to your point, just this last week, I got a draft copy, and I have one here in front of me, of a document that's called the Blueprint to Mariner. And it's got the Coast Guard symbols on it and members of our Navy recruitment commands that are working on this document that would allow a sailor coming out of Great Lakes to have the opportunity to get credit for all of that activity that they've got, and be in a position to be handed a credential very quickly after leaving the service. We have a requirement over the next 10 years for 74,000 mariners in the United States, and we have got to come up with innovative ways to attract these individuals to this service, because without them, we're not going to war, because we need all of our military Sealift Command vessels and our commercial U.S. flag fleet to be able to go to sea and take our nation to war. Thanks, Master Chief.
Thanks, sir. And the last question.
Master Chief, this is, I'm Master Chief Skip Bowen. I was a retired Master Chief of the Coast Guard. I wanted to comment on what the Marine General was saying about Marine boot camp. You know, during my time in 2007, I visited every single service recruit training because we were looking at revamping our own recruit training. And I'm going to tell you, he is absolutely right. Those that are criticizing the Marine for this, they need to go down to Paris Island and check this out. Let me tell you, it's needed. It is a good process. And if I could have figured out a way to do it for the Coast Guard, I would have brought it to the Coast Guard. That's just a fact. I just wanted to say that.
Thank you.
Thanks, Master Chief. Last question, then we'll go to have some four questions, is for Sergeant Major Green. I just want to say, what are the biggest differences that you see today, the makeup of personnel in today's sea services compared to when you first joined so many, many, many years ago?
I think the biggest difference I see today versus when I joined a few days ago, the amount of balls, you know, crystal balls, the youth of our service have to juggle. You know, when I came in the Marine Corps, there's some older personnel in the stage than I am. So I don't know why y'all picking on me. I'm probably the youngest one up here. Minus you, ma'am. I know you don't age. I got it. I don't go there because I got a wife and a daughter and a mom. You know, so. But seriously, you know, you think back. I think back to 33 years. I didn't have a car. I didn't have a checkbook. I didn't even have a bank account. I wouldn't even remember Navy Federal Credit Union when I first came in. I didn't have to worry about any of that. I got a hard check. If I wanted to go out in town, I got on a bus. I didn't have a cell phone. I didn't have Wi-Fi. I mean, everything was just the beer garden was there. The beer machine was there. I didn't have to go get it. I mean, it's just, everything was so freaking simple. I mean, the youth of the military, and I don't call them kids, because first off, we don't recruit kids and put weapons in their hands to go out and possibly kill people. So I'd appreciate it if we stopped calling them kids. They are not kids when they raise their right hand and say they're going to defend this nation. They're young Americans. They're the youth of our military. But I'll tell you, they have a lot more on their plate than I had on mine. I'd sit down in the evening after work, spit shine my boots. We don't even spit shine boots anymore. I press my camis. We don't press camis anymore. In the effort to give them back time, to give back time, so they have more time to themselves. I don't know if that was necessarily the right thing to do. I don't know. Because when I look back at my time, I mean, I could just focus. We talk about iPads and all that. You know, some sergeants, we bring sergeants in to the Executive Force Preservation Board. We do that twice a year from the sergeant's course. We just have a gunny go out and pick them. She's a part of the safety team. She bring them back, and they tell us, hey, a couple of them, hey, Sergeant Major, Assistant Commandant of the Marine Corps, I wish y'all would stop putting everything on MarineNet on the computer and then complaining about us wanting to take our cell phone to the field. You put everything on the computer. I may want to do, you know, some professional military education when I'm not doing anything in the field, but you tell me to put my cell phone up. You didn't give me a book. Think about that. You didn't give me a book. You gave me everything electronically. You had to still, you see, I give off an electronic signature when we're in the field, so the enemy might, you know, sneak up on us. Well, you can't have it both ways. Leadership of the Marine Corps, decide which one you want. So they want the same thing I want. They want kneecap to kneecap, leadership, coaching, mentoring, training, teaching, and when all else fails, counseling. But counseling is a last resort. There are only about five reasons that Marines come in the Corps to be something better than self, because they've had family members that have served, maybe not in the Marine Corps, but in a branch of service, and they're carrying on the legacy. Because they have failed at something, such as myself, when I had my scholarship taken away in college because I didn't do what the band director said. I tell Marines that because I want them to know. I am not perfect. I have walked in the same shoes you walk in. I'm proud to say that I failed at something, but I wasn't measured by how far I failed. I'm measured by how far I get back up. Too often we won't tell the youth that we have failed at things. Believe me, they know that we're not perfect. Share the stories with them. They also come in because they've been hurt by someone, or they've hurt someone. Those about the five patriotism. That's about it. That's it. I ask this question every time I go out and talk to Marines. I was down in Norfolk yesterday, asked the same question. No one else can raise their hand. Two Marines. They made a bet while drunk. Flipped the coin. Landed on heads. Heads was the Marine Corps. And they came in. But I took them right back to the same question. Were you doing anything with your life? So obviously you wanted to be a part of something better. You wanted to be an A branch of service. It just happened to land on heads. I say, well, that's what you get for playing with a two-headed quarter. So the difference, the biggest difference is everything we desire from them versus everything that was required of us. It's a huge difference. We talk about all this technology. We're going to put it on their backs. They're going to be the ones that run it. And they can, and they are running it. They can absolutely do it. I was reading Scientific American magazine a couple of months ago, and it struck me that it's not them understanding us that's the problem. It's us understanding them. It was fascinating, the article in the magazine. It talked about the brain and the different parts of the brain that grow at the same rate. It's not the parts of the brain that's the problem. It's not that the youth don't get what we got at the same age. It's the connectors. It's the connectors where information travel from one part to another that's a lot thinner in their brain. That's the part scientists have to figure out. Why are those connectors so much thinner than our generation? Could it be because we've introduced them to so much technology? So much technology until it's changing. It's changing the way the brain really grows and processes information. We think they have a problem. I don't think they have a problem. I think it's just a difference. Like I said earlier, this technological boom that we're in now is something we've never experienced before in the world. Nothing. Anyone that wants to know how to make something can find it on the internet, either above ground or underground, because there is an underground internet that most of us, we don't even go there, but some actually go there, and they can find it. It's the amount of glass balls they're judging.
Thanks. Okay, I think we're a little bit over, but I do want to open up for a couple of questions from the floor before we close out. I think happy hours after this, so I don't want to stand in between that. But take a couple questions from the floor before we close out. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I am the parent of a future Marine. Hoorah.
Hoorah.
And I was wondering, looking on message boards and things like that, I find that there are a lot of helicopter parents out there. How does that play into your perspective, especially with all of the technology that is out there, so that everybody can see what's going on? Do you communicate with them, or is that one of those things that you guys have a very tough time dealing with, especially with new recruits?
Yeah, what a great point. The one of the things that I do on Thursday morning, the Sergeant Major and I, before graduations, at 5:30, we'll meet with the Marines who are about to graduate, who were assessed by their senior drill instructors as having been the most improved Marines in their respective platoons. And it's an awesome conversation, very, very inspiring. One of the questions I'll always ask them is, what did you find to be the most challenging aspect of boot camp? And a lot of this is to some of the great points the Sergeant Major has made. And one answer, you know, after having this conversation for three straight years that I've really come to appreciate, is some of them will say, you know, sir, this is the first time in my life I haven't had a cell phone in my hand. And some of them will even say, hey, it was really cool, sir. I actually wrote a letter, and I got a letter, you know, in the mail. He's like, it's pretty cool. You can save it. But you know, to kind of think about that, you know, young men and women who are 18 or 19, and like I said, I've got five kids, and I've watched this unfold in my own family. They've never been without
you know, that that cell phone. And a lot of times, you know, with my kids, more so with my wife than me, but it's a constant conversation. They may go out for the evening, but my wife, they'll be checking in, you know, every hour, hour and a half. It's really what they've gotten used to. And while I would say we've got some work to do in making sure as Marines that we keep up with that and we communicate with them in the fashion we're used to, I would turn that a little bit around and say, you know, that method of communicating, in my mind, it makes it that much more important that we're having the kneecap-to-kneecap discussions, sitting down with them, having a conversation, not trying to lead them through the media devices. You know, we can send an email sometimes and feel good about ourselves, but, you know, to actually walk down to where a Marine walks or lives and to look them in the eye, find out what they're concerned about, you know, what their hopes are, you know, what are the latest rumors. We continue to believe that's the essence of leadership. You know, the platoon commander's notebook, where I've written down all the pertinent details about every Marine in my unit, and I don't have to run back and, you know, break out the computer and get out a spreadsheet. I just know it because I'm having that constant conversation with them, not just patting them on the back and asking about the game and walking away and thinking we communicated, but really having a meaningful discussion with them, you know, really frequently. There were a lot of General Mattis's name came up on the last panel, but when I was up at the Naval War College, he came up and talked to everybody, and at the end he just said, get out from behind your computers, get off the phone, walk around your workspace, and look people in the eye and talk to them, and that's right on target. So I acknowledge everything you're saying. I've seen that in my own family, in my own life, but you know, we gotta be a little bit better than that in the military and getting to know those great young men and women and in talking to them in the old-fashioned way.
Let me just add on to that as a parent of a son who's in the Coast Guard. I was also in General Bierman's job at Training Center Cape May, where our recruit training happens. And I was there for 3 years as an 06, and we had a lot of the helicopter moms and dads. But we tried to look at that as an opportunity. It's a force multiplier. This is the first opportunity to introduce many of those moms and dads to the United States Coast Guard. That was an opportunity every Friday at graduation to welcome them in and make them part of our team. Because some point down the road, that young man or woman is going to have a challenge in their life. And we hope the chief is there, okay? We hope the CO is there. We hope their shipmate is there. But their mom and dad may be there also. And their mom and dad need to know that, you know what, this is a family, this is a team, you know, and we're all in this together. And so it was an opportunity for us to introduce them to the United States Coast Guard, introduce them to the United States military. So we tried to capitalize on it. We were perfect all the time, no. But it was a challenge, yes. And I also learned not to do the same thing, many of those same things with my two sons. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. I'm John Wertman. I work with the American Association of Geographers. We're a nonprofit research and academic education association. Yesterday morning during the chief's panel, General Neller indicated that only about 30% of today's high school graduates in the United States are authorized or able to go directly into the military because of their qualifications. When I was down in the exhibit hall, I picked up this from the ONR booth. It's the new Naval STEM strategy. Just came out. I wanted to ask, you know, what type of work are you guys doing when you engage with America's K-12 system or higher ed system to try to, you know, really promote the message that we need STEM graduates and folks like this?
I hope you guys are doing something because we don't have money to do much of that. So we're trying to glom off you guys.
Well, that's a great question. You know, I think a lot of times in the recruiting horizon, we have a tendency just to kind of think about, hey, high school juniors, seniors, maybe just out of high school, coming out of college, things along those lines. But really, we need to start planting those seeds very early on to make sure that they understand what's available and to get people interested in the STEM career fields. I'd say one of the best selling points for all of us is that we don't just talk about learning about STEM or getting on a whiteboard and drawing about STEM. We're going to put that gear in your hands, and you're going to actually go out and use it, and you're going to use it doing something very noble. So if we, through pretty aggressive outreach, through career fairs, air shows, any means that we can get out to the public and tell our story about what it is we do, how we do it, but why we do it as well, you know, for the bigger cause. And, you know, we've talked about this kind of stuff. What is it that's really important about what it is we provide to the nation and our nation's defense? But what is that value proposition for that individual that we're trying to influence? And why do they want to come onto our team and do something that's bigger than themselves and make a contribution to something that, frankly, will be the foundation for the rest of their lives? This is an avenue for us to get kind of into that STEM environment, but it's also an opportunity for us to really talk about what and who we are and why we're important and why we think that they may be a good candidate to be on our team if they so choose.
Yes, sir.
So by day I'm an engineer, but nights and weekends I'm a U.S. Naval Sea Cadet Corps instructor. What are you doing to work with the Sea Cadets to leverage a group of young men and women who have a keen interest in the military? And by the way, we have one of our cadets in the Merchant Marine Academy, and another is swearing into the Marine Corps next month.
I'll take a stab at that one. As far as the high school programs go, I'm assuming they're in high school, correct?
13.
Or middle school, somewhere in that pipeline. We have programs in the high school that reach down and do mentoring, along with Marines, where we've paired up with schools all across America to reach out to those programs and talk to those students, not on a recruiting level, more so on a mentoring, teaching, coaching level. We have a JROTC program, a junior ROTC program. My son actually participated during his high school time. He's a senior this year. And never in my wildest dream did I think he'd come in the Marine Corps. As a matter of fact, I never talked to him about it. I just asked him to be successful, protect the name on your left breast pocket, you're not U.S. Marine, and protect the one you were born on your right breast pocket, green. Go out and do something successful. He chose the Naval Academy. That's where he'll push off to June 30th and start his little plebe summer on his own, on his own. But it wasn't because I talked to him. It was because he seen a program in the school that was successful. And I even asked when he joined in the 10th grade, because we were coming from Germany where there was no program, what made you join JROTC? He said, Dad, because I've been at the school about 2 or 3 months, and you know, the kids there, you know, my classmates, they're pretty tight. They do things together. They do community service. He says, sort of like, you know, the Marine Corps and the military. So I think through, you know, community programs, outreach, doing things outside of the uniform, giving back, I think that's the greatest thing we could do to encourage, you know, youth to do positive things. Not as a recruiting tool, but just to do positive things. And if we do that, because of the lack of that outside of the gate, that will automatically attract young people to the military. A lot of them we don't have to go out and find. Some of them find us. A few of them don't know we exist. Once they figure it out, they like the product, they love the product that we produce.
Just clarification, the Sea Cadets is not actually an ROTC
program. I know. But they're students, right?
Students.
Yeah, I'm saying, I'm not just talking about ROTC programs. When we go out to work with schools, these are schools that have, such as in the area around here, they have no military affiliation. When we talk about mentoring programs, there's one at Henderson Hall, right there in Arlington, right beside the Pentagon. They go around in 3 different schools that have nothing to do with military, nothing. Just mentoring kids, helping them with math, helping them with reading, physical fitness, just being involved. We require Marines to give back, to do more than just go across the water to defend the nation. We owe something back to the youth of America. And that has nothing to do with recruiting. It's just being a good example. I hope that answers your question.
Sir, along the lines of Sea Cadets, specifically for the Coast Guard's involvement, we see it as a great grassroots, low-cost, high-return-on-investment opportunity. So we encourage our members to get involved, as Sergeant Major was talking about, getting involved. That's part of our DNA. We've opened up Cape May on many occasions to bring Sea Cadets in for some of their summer training. In fact, a couple of years ago, we had a, I would call it a jamboree. You probably have a more technical term for it, a more appropriate term for it, where sea cadets from across the nation came into Cape May, and we were able to put them up. Unfortunately, we're not able to do that now because we're up in our throughput through Cape May. But we see the sea cadets, sponsored by the Navy League, as a phenomenal opportunity for us to get the word out to young men and women who have the propensity to serve or be part of something larger themselves, that hey, the Coast Guard's out there. That's a good place to go. Also, if you're thinking about joining the military, you got the Navy, you got the Marine Corps, but don't forget the Coast Guard. So we love it, and in fact, many of our folks are here locally are involved, and across the nation are involved also.
And I think I can speak the same with regards to the Navy. Had the opportunity to speak at a Sea Cadet graduation when they did a workshop at Great Lakes, Illinois. So where there's affiliation, I think all the services are stepping out. And we usually find out that there's some type of retiree a little bit associated with that, so they have a little in. But I think we're all inspired by those young men and women that want to be part of something bigger than themselves. And I think we all give back to them, young men and women. We make them do more push-ups than anybody else, though, because they are young. So let's say that.
Okay. Yeah. I think we've got time for two more. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the time that you took today to come out and speak with us. My name is Nigel Thies, Naval Surface Warfare Center, and my question today is actually for our MSC. We know that our Navy needs a strong, robust merchant marine and a robust sealift capacity to support continuous operations around the globe. Being a former State Academy graduate, my question is, what is MSC doing to better recruit individuals from the State Academies and Kings Point to work at MSC? I support the Department of the Navy as a federal civilian. Many of my classmates are port engineers, valuable skills that the Navy does need, but they also need qualified merchant mariners to support MSC. And it's a challenging goal. Military to mariner will help, but it's not a true replacement for four dedicated years at school training to sail merchant ships.
Thanks for your question. It's a great question, and we are struggling with that. That said, there's a lot of interdependencies that go along with that. One of them is the price of oil, just to put it out there. The other is the overall state of the economy. Right now, with where we are with the price of oil being somewhat, depressed, there's been massive close downs of drilling wells and so forth down in the Gulf of Mexico. Well, what's happened to all of those certified, degreed chief engineers, and other qualifications, deckhands and so forth, that have gone to those oil rigs? Well, they've all come back off of those rigs, and they've lined up outside our door. So right snapshot in time today, we're doing okay with most of our officer ratings for those that we need to fill. But all I need is a blip in the economy or a blip in oil price, and next thing we know, there's massive recruiting going on by the oil companies, and guys and gals will leave us to go take those jobs. So this is a significant problem. What I'm more worried about, I look at those as short-term blips. What I'm more worried about is the long-term cycle. We are struggling as a transportation industry. When I go to large transportation organizational meetings where you talk about men and women that go to sea, men and women that ride the rails, men and women that drive trucks, men and women that fly airplanes, millennials don't want to do this. And it scares me. What do we do about it? Put incentives out there, the biggest ones we can. We're trying to bring these young men and women into this and get them excited about it, but quite frankly, it is a struggle to get a millennial interested in rolling up their sleeves and going in the bilge of a ship after a four-year engineering degree and doing this work. So, your question is spot on, but we're pouring everything at it that we possibly have.
Yeah. Appreciate it. Thank you. Tell that sea cadet to look up MSC when he graduates.
Hi, Megan.
Okay, hi. So this question is for the Marines, actually, about having gender-segregated boot camp. How do you guarantee When they're spending this time learning how to be Marines, learning what the Marine Corps is about, how do you guarantee that once they're out of that training, they're going to be able to reintegrate and the men will be able to look up to women when they've never been told to look up to women before? How can you assure that once they get out, everyone is a Marine again instead of a female Marine and a male Marine?
Well, the integration in combat training occurs when they have 12 weeks in the Corps. But our position is better that integration occur once you have men and women who have developed a level of confidence, who have developed some armor and some thick skin for the type of things that they're going to deal with. Better to level the playing field. I mean, the real question is, do you want that integration occurring plus or minus 3 months in the military when they have had all their best characteristics brought out by a drill instructor, when they've had some same-sex role models that they've spent in very close quarters with that they can look up to and emulate? Do you want that integration occurring at that level, or do you want a young woman who is days in the military trying to figure it all out at that point? Again, I have nothing but respect for the different methods that the different services use. I can tell you, out of my five kids, three are daughters. A couple talk about joining the military. I would much rather I wish, regardless of what branch of the service they talk about going into, and Marine Corps is not on the top of the list for at least one of them, I'd rather that they went through that basic training without the distraction of the whole boy-girl piece, you know, learning from a strong, principled woman, you know, how do I step up and be a woman in that integrated world before they actually have to put it to the test. So I understand the thrust of your comment. It's a great question. But again, you know, our belief is let's teach them to be men and women before we integrate them at a very early point, at the three-month point in their career, going forward for many years.
If I can elaborate on that just a little bit. Having traveled in January, having traveled to every services recruit training to see exactly what the beginning product is and the end product, the Marine Corps' concept of recruit training is that every Marine's a rifleman. That's where we start. No other service has that start point. No other service is trying to make everyone one rifleman. When I talked about locating, closing with, that's where we start. From day one on the yellow footprints, when they get off the bus, you have to recognize the physiological differences in our recruit training because it's so physical. Day one, on the pull-up bar, average female coming off the bus, I'm talking about recruit training, not the officer candidate school. In recruit training, 0 to 1 pull-up for the female, 12 to 15 for the male. So some want us to put both side by side for 3 months. And how is that going to encourage the female? Starting from ground zero, what encouragement does that give when they go on hikes, starting with about 45 pounds on their back, every Saturday? And it's going to increase, and the mileage is going to increase until the end of the 3 months. How is that encouraging from day one? Well, General Bierman is saying, we use a progressive system, and the fourth phase of recruit training, when you look at everybody else's boot camp, everyone else does all that training in one place. The Marine Corps is the one service that takes the combat training. It's someplace else because it involves 50 caliber machine guns. We need large amounts of space. Nobody else needs that kind of space, the Army, but they have that space because their bases are huge where they do recruit training. Just so happened in the Marine Corps, we have Paris Island and San Diego beside the airport. You're not shooting any rounds beside the airport. So the Marines get on buses and they go to Marine combat training at Camp Pendleton. They do third phase of boot camp at Camp Pendleton, all their field training. On the East Coast, it's done at Paris Island. But when they go to Marine combat training, they go to Camp Lejeune in North Carolina, because you have those large amounts of space. It would be different if East Coast recruit training was at Camp Lejeune and West Coast boot camp was at Camp Pendleton. We wouldn't be having some of this conversation, because the fourth phase of that part of training in between basic school, MOS training, and recruit training would be a part of what you see, and you would further understand that they get the same integration process. It just happens a little bit slower because our target audience and the end product is a lot different.
You know, and the Sergeant Major, he mentioned the perceptions and the incremental growth of the females. I completely agree, but I would also bring it back to the view of the males. You know, there's a myth for those who haven't seen our boot camp that the separate training decreases the respect of the sexes for the other one. I completely disagree. You know, the real question is, do I want those male Marines first meeting that female again when she's doing that one pull-up or no pull-ups that first day on the pull-up bar, or do I want them meeting her when she's tough, a little bit sassy, doing four or five pull-ups at the conclusion of boot camp, when we bring them all together in our combat training and what we believe is a more level playing field? Let's give them the time to work with and to be mentored and developed by some of the very best male and female drill instructors, respectively, that we can find before we put them into that integrated environment. Some of the young men and women have had nothing in their lives, again, because of, you know, that role model that wasn't there or the one they would have been better off without. They've had nothing that prepares them to deal and be effective in an integrated environment. A lot of times they've been abused. A lot of times their confidence has been chipped away. So let's build those things up before we put them together, and they have to deal with all that other stuff. We are as dedicated as any of the other services to an integrated Marine Corps, to an integrated military. And we're going about that with a happy heart, but we are going to armor our males and females in the most effective way possible, but before we bring everybody together.
And by the way, ma'am, we have females that can do 20 pull-ups, 20 plus pull-ups, that can run just as fast as males.